It was the turn of the millennium. After 1,000 years, the first numeral in the year column was going to be beginning with the number 2. It was also a time when a new generation was coming of age, and I was one of them, the millennials, the Gen Y. In this dozen years from their primary school to their college years, they had seen several changes in their life. Postcards were getting replaced with emails. TVs getting replaced with computers. The Fiats and Ambassadors were getting replaced with the Fords and Toyotas. The Thumbs Up Limca and Gold Spot was now replaced with Pepsi, Coca-Cola, Sprite, and Fanta. It was just a dozen years and the world around them had changed. It was around the time when I just entered college. Being a student of commerce, business, and economics, I ventured to study the evolution of the Indian economic system, saw two distinct philosophies that dominated the last half century. On one end was Mahatma Gandhi's Sarvodaya, which focused on ensuring an egalitarian society. The Quit India movement had motivated lakhs of individuals to court arrest for India's political independence. My maternal grandfather, Professor C.H. Shah, was one among those youth who courted arrest and went to jail for 2 years and stayed in Ahmedabad jail between 1942 and 44. It was thanks to that generation that we enjoy the freedom today. But we often ask for our rights. What about our duties? At the other end of the economic spectrum was the first Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, who envisaged an economic system that was inspired by the Soviet Union, where the public sector was going to take center stage. This objective of ensuring controls over the private sector took an extreme turn, where over the next quarter century, we saw extreme forms of industrial regulation and licensing. We saw the nationalization of banks, and we saw a taxation system without a parallel in the world. Do you know that between 1960-61 and 72-73, taxes in India increased from 77% to 95%? In certain cases, with the additional wealth tax, a person earning 100 rupees had to pay 105 rupees as a tax. This was the birth of the black economy. Another idea came into being in this period. There were economists like Professor Rajakrishna from the UK who said, oh, India does not have the capacity to grow. At 3% is maximum what India can grow, and they called it the Hindu rate of growth, as if Hinduism and the Indian religions were responsible for India's slow rate of growth. Around the year 2000, there was a fascinating study by the OECD which said that between the year 1 AD to 1750 AD, there was one country which contributed 35% of global trade. Which was that country? India. Between 1750 and 1850, it came down from 35% to 25%. And between 1850 and 1950, India's contribution came down from 25% to 5%, whereas Great Britain's contribution went up from 5% to 25%. So it wasn't about the capacity of India to deliver, but the kind of systems and the colonization that was responsible for what was happening. Let's come back to more positive times. After 45 years, India finally became economically liberalized. We had delicensing, deregulation, and a far more expansive system of the economy. And I still remember the day, and I was in college, when the Bombay Stock Exchange indices crossed the 5,000 mark. And on the 27th story of the GG Boy Towers, which is the headquarters of BSE, 5,000 balloons were left into the skies as a mark of crossing the 5,000 points. Today, we are at 35,000 points. In those days, the newspaper was also full of stories about the IT success story of the Silicon Valley. Google, Yahoo, eBay became the natural destinations for aspiring talent. And there were ridiculous market valuations in those times about the Silicon Valley success stories. But within a few years, the bubble burst, the NASDAQ lost $5 trillion in market cap, and once again, everyone was disillusioned. Even before the dust was settled, a new genre of companies made their presence felt. One among them most well-known, for the right or wrong reasons, was Enron. At its peak in 2000-2001, it had a revenue of $111 billion, and it had a stock market price of $90. As times progressed in a couple of years, skeletons tumbled from the cupboards, and investigation revealed that Enron's practices formed an encyclopedia of all the wrong that can happen in a corporation and by its leaders. Within days, the $90 shares became a few pennies. I was shattered as a young college student. What is the purpose of business? Is it just creating wealth? Is it just profit making? Are those who are contributing to the success of the business not equally eligible to be part of its success? Or are those who invest in those businesses alone eligible to gain from its success? Most often, as it happened in 2008, those who invested in the companies, the founders, the leaders, earned handsome salary rises and successes, whereas all the others lost out. And the bailing out was at the munificence of the taxpayers' money. There are examples which are exceptions. And I would like to go back to 1922. It was the time when Tata Steel was at its lowest ebb. Thanks to the policies of the British government, the Tatas, and the Tata Steel especially, was about to be shut down. One of the investors said, "Why don't you shut down this company? It's not doing well." Incidentally, the Tatas had helped the British government immensely in the World War I, but when the war concluded, the industries were opened, and in came all the competition and dumping of steel. R.D. Tata, one of the founders, said, "I will shut down Tata Steel only over my dead body." What happened after that is an example for the likes of Nirav Modi or Vijay Mallya, who are in headlines. Dorabji Tata, the son of the founder, mortgaged his personal wealth to the tune of 1 crore, including his wife's jewelry and the Jubilee diamond, which is twice the size of the Kohinoor, in order to get a loan from the State Bank of India so that the employees can be paid their salary and the company remains afloat. I thought such good things happen only in India and bad things happen only overseas. That was the mind of a millennial in college in those years. And by the time I moved for post-graduation, I found that Enron's brother was in our own neighborhood. Sathya Computer Company proved my notion wrong. A company that had won the Golden Peacock Award for corporate governance had fudged accounts to the tune of 5,000 crores. Both the company and its leader underwent severe investigation. I was reminded of a story I had always heard as a kid of this thief who had looted the neighborhood and was walking with great pride on the street, thinking that all this booty is for him to keep. On the road, there was one water tank, and on that tank, he saw one kid crying. He went there and asked him, "What happened, young boy?" He said, "Uncle, I have lost my gold chain in this water tank. I was having a bath somewhere here. Can you help me out?" So this man, this thief's eyes twinkled. He thought, after all, he's a kid. I will have the gold chain and the booty that I have gathered and a glorious month ahead. He put his booty on the side of the water tank, went inside to search for the chain. When he came out, he realized that the chain was nothing but a fiction, an imagination. And when he looked around, he realized that the boy had vanished with his booty that he had gathered with so much of effort by thieving in the neighborhood. Short-termism doesn't pay, was my lesson as a young millennial working through his doctoral thesis. I realized that corporations who have far long-term visions are going to be the ones who are going to survive. I came across this book, which was written by Rakesh Khurana, the dean of the Harvard College, which was titled, "From Higher Aims to Hired Hands." and which analyzed the devolution of the business school education in the West, where education, and especially management education, which was meant to provide higher objectives to the individuals graduating from these prestigious business schools, to a mere platform to gain jobs called hired hands. That got me thinking to an analogy which I had read as a growing up, as a teenager, of the human body. We often forget, but it's something worth reflecting over. When we want to have a fruit, and we all remember the days when we may have taken a stone to pluck a fruit from the tree, maybe a sweet mango or something else, there is so much of coordination that is involved from the time the thought comes into our mind to the time the fruit is coming into our hand. The mind tells the hand picks up the stone is thrown at the fruit falls down, the legs move to the fruit is picked up, the fruit is consumed, the digestive enzymes digest it, and the arteries take the blood all over the body, and the body is energized. There is so much of synchronization and harmony in all that this microsystem of the human body. Can't this be replicated in a corporation or an economy? So I thought. And that's when my exploratory journey began. In my doctoral thesis, I studied the opinions of experts over the last several millennia, and I observed that over 3,000 years, experts like Chanakya, like Socrates, like Adam Smith, belonging to different countries, had a similar observation that economic life should be subservient to the good life meant for society. And societies succeed when economic and ethical interests coalesce. Adam Smith, a Scottish moral philosopher, who is known as the father of modern economics, had written his most outstanding work called The Theory of Moral Sentiments in 1759. A decade and a half later, he wrote what is his most celebrated work, The Wealth of Nations. He observed that moral philosophy should form the basis of economic success. Unfortunately, the world today has focused only on his economic work and not on the kind of integration that he suggested. I met several experts in India and overseas, over 200 interviews with corporate leaders, industry captains, and all of them had one thing to say. Capitalism is among the most powerful platform for social cooperation ever invented. It is a platform where all of us can get together to achieve that which no single individual can achieve. Yet, to say profits are the objective of such corporations is an anomaly. Profits are an outcome. The purpose is most important. To say that profits are the purpose of an organization is like saying that breathing is the objective of life. That's the kind of mistakes that we usually make. And that's when I came upon what I called integration of stakeholder interests into corporate decision making. And I called such organizations as win-win corporations. Win-win corporations are those where we look at the interests of the organization and its diverse stakeholders both winning together in order to attain successful outcomes. It's not me at your cost. It's not you at my cost. It's we together who achieve a particular objective. The Taj and the Oberoi Hotel provide a fascinating example, and I'd like to share that before I go towards the conclusion of my presentation. This was in the year 2009. The terrorist attacks had just concluded a month earlier, the three-day siege on Mumbai. And Taj and Oberoi were both victims. My next-door neighbor, husband and wife, lost their lives in the attack at the Oberoi. At that time, in January 2009, there was a function in Taj. But there was a short circuit in the hotel, and it was suggested that it's not safe to have the wedding reception of that high-profile businessman in Taj. So please look for an alternative venue. They did not have a hotel nearby because the Taj Lands End in Mumbai is about an hour away. What do we do? Karambir Kang, the general manager, was in two minds. That's when Hemant Oberoi, his chief chef, came up and said, Oberoi has a grand banquet hall. It's available this evening. why don't you pick up the phone and call them? Imagine collaborating with your competitor in order to ensure that your customer benefits. Karambir did pick up the phone, Oberoi did agree. Taj food was served in Oberoi by Oberoi staff. An unprecedented gesture in the corporate world. But there was a story to it. 25 years earlier, when Oberoi came into the Mumbai hospitality space, Taj had put out an advertisement. We welcome our competitors to share the prosperity of the city of Mumbai. That goodwill 35 years ago stayed to their advantage, and they worked towards win-win solutions. Every organization needs to deftly manage different stakeholders. There is this example, a story that I often share, of this trader at whose doorstep landed two ladies. They said, we are the goddess poverty and the goddess of wealth. Please tell us who is the more beautiful among the two. This trader was in two minds. I'll be cursed if I say either way. So he told the goddess of wealth, please go at the entrance of the door and walk towards me. He told the goddess of poverty, please walk from here to the entrance of the door. Then he said to the goddess of wealth, you look beautiful when you enter my house. He told the goddess of poverty, you look equally beautiful when you leave my house. That is the way corporations need to deftly manage several stakeholders. India is at a great position. 700 years, we suffered different kinds of colonization. 45 years, we had different kinds of experiments. And in the last 25 years, we've succeeded and risen to become among the top three economies in terms of purchasing power parity after US and China. We are four times the population of US and one-third its geography. So we have 12x the complexities. And China, of course, is a communist country with a lot of centralized regulation. And yet India has been able to do so well and succeed by the sheer dint of hard work and the entrepreneurial nature of its individuals. The next 15 years are going to be equally fabulous. By 2030, 60% of India's population will be above the age of 20. We'll have 100 crore people in the middle class, and the per capita income will rise from $1,500 to five times that amount. That's going to be an amazing capacity to purchase, to grow, and to succeed. What will mar this success story are the social indicators. And that's where the role of millennials like you and me come into place, that we should build organizations which are win-win corporations. We should build organizations that focus on balanced, sustainable, and responsible growth. And these organizations are also financially successful, like the ones I've studied in win-win corporations, or for that matter, my latest book on the Tata Group, where they created far more wealth than their peers on the stock markets, while also ensuring a sustained and responsible growth rate. So that's the kind of promise that lies ahead of us. We have three distinct advantages. We have the opportunity and the freedom to grow. We have a process-oriented taxation system, and we have a mandate through our CSR to look at the interests of the underprivileged. It's on us to set the ideal example of leadership. Who is an ideal leader, the kind the millennials have all the potential to become? The one who has a vision, the one who puts together an enabling ecosystem, and the one who walks the talk. I'm sure each one of us here is grown over the age of flying paper planes and has getting into the age to become the movers and shakers who will work towards transformative outputs, long-lasting outcomes, and phenomenal impact so that India can be an example for its peer developing economies like we were when we achieved political independence. We can definitely set an example for achieving the economic success story despite all our limitations and complexities. Come, let's join in making of this success story. Thank you.